Okay, but before that, let's take a moment and go to God in prayer. Yeah, listen, close your eyes. Yeah, close your eyes. Come on, you can do it. Close your eyes, no matter where you are. Close your eyes. And if you're driving, don't close your eyes. Close your eyes and think about what it is God did for you today. Think about it. What did he do for you today? He started by allowing you to hear the alarm clock or the kids, or he allowed you to smell whatever food was cooking in the kitchen. He allowed you to have a moment of inspiration in your body where your ears, your nose, your eyes, your senses collectively came together so that you could experience something that you've never experienced before. There's never been a day like today. There's never been a moment like this moment. He did that for you early this morning. Now, I don't know what else he did for you, but I'm glad that he allowed you the opportunity and experiences that he did today. Now, with that in mind, let's pray. Yeah, don't wait for me. You start praying wherever you are. Yeah, you pray. I challenge you to pray out loud. Don't worry about people thinking that you're crazy. Trust me. If they're in earshot of hearing you pray, they probably need to hear somebody pray. Okay? They might join in with you. Come on. Take this moment and pray. Yeah, I feel you praying. Wherever you are, come on. Get something in your mouth to say to God. Come on. Say something great to him. Yeah. Remind him of how great you think he is. Yeah. Come on. You can do it. Don't stare at me. Don't look at me. I want you praying right now wherever you are. Yeah. I know you're used to praying silent. Open your mouth and let God hear your voice. Come on. You could have woke up this morning and not had a voice. Come on. Pray wherever you are. Yeah. I feel you praying. I feel us getting stronger. Come on. Pray. Pray, saints. Pray wherever you are. Yeah, pray in the comfort of your living room. Pray right there while you're at work listening on your AirPods. Wherever you are. Come on, join us in prayer tonight. Come on, God, we thank you for another awesome day. Even when the world categorizes this as crisis, you are good to us in the middle of our crisis. God, you've been faithful. You've been exactly who we needed you to be in this moment. And God, because of that, we have faith in you. Because of that, we strengthen our trust in you. God, when we woke up this morning, we had no idea what it was going to be like at 7 p.m. God, when we woke up this morning, we didn't know what the government was going to do. But God, you've got all things in your hands. You have control. Yeah, we listen to the voices of other people, but we know that in the spiritual realm, God, you have all things in control. The Bible says that you can turn the hearts of kings. And because of that, God, we don't put our hope and trust in the government because they're people. They are apt to fail us. But God, we put our trust in you because, God, you've never failed us before. So tonight, God, we've gathered from all over the world. We gathered over this great innovation that you've called the internet so that we can bond our hearts and minds together. Not praying on each other, God, but tonight we're praying with each other. Yeah. In the time and season when we sanitize our hands before we touch anything, God, we reach out and touch and agree with our hearts. We reach out and touch and agree with our minds. God, we reach out and touch and agree knowing that when two of us or three of us are gathered together, in your name, you will be in the midst of us. You didn't say that we had to be in the same building, God. You said that you would be in the midst of us. You didn't say that we had to be physically touching, God, but we're touching and agreeing in the spirit right now in the name of Jesus. Now, God, we ask that your Holy Spirit meet us wherever we are, even in a room by ourselves, because we are gathered collectively across the globe, God. Let your Holy Spirit fill the room with us. We want to feel your hand on our shoulder. We want to feel your hand anointing our heads. We want to feel your hand on our backs, pressing us and pushing us. God, we thank you tonight for what you're doing in the midst of us. God, heal, deliver, and set free. Even before the moment of worship, even before the word even comes forth, God, do it right now. God, there are some people who can't wait a couple of more minutes. God, they need you right now. Go before us, God. Go before our words. Go before our movement and actions, God, and be who you are to us. God, we love you because you're doing it right now. We love you because people all over the globe are being saved right now. We love you because people all over the globe are being healed right now, being set free right now, being delivered right now. God, we don't count this as just another moment, God. We count this as a movement, God. We don't want to be in this moment, God. We want to make this a movement, God. So, God, move us, transform us, transfigure us, translate us, Lord. Lord, make us who you want us to be in this moment. God, as your word comes forth tonight, allow us to not be distracted. We know we're going to see notifications from other people, God. But for this night, Lord, this night right here, allow us to be steadfast and focused on your word. Lord God, in the worship moment, God, allow us to lift our hands all over our homes, all over our loved ones' homes, wherever we're gathering tonight, Lord. Allow us to lift our hands unashamedly, God. Not because other people see us tonight, God, but because we lift our hands and give you sacrifice. We lift our hands and lift our all up to you, God, in our offering tonight. We lift our hands, God, and say we surrender to you. God, do something awesome in the midst of us tonight. Let miracles happen in the midst of us. We know you're going to do it because you've always done it for us before. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Hey, come on, do it. Clap your hands all over the place. Come on, clap your hands for the glory of the Lord tonight. Listen, I said I got a good surprise for you. I believe this is going to bless you. A sister of ours, Sister Jamila Carney, from somewhere other than Tampa, Florida. Yeah, I think she's from Wisconsin. Hey, Sister Jamila, thank you for watching. Look, Sister Jamila sent me a clip of her dancing in her home. Yeah, dancing at home. She sent me a clip of her dancing at home, and I want to share that clip with you tonight, all right? Listen, this is not the moment for you to tip out the back of the church. That ain't what we're doing. This is not the moment. This is not a bathroom break. This is not the break to go get something from the kitchen. Listen. I want you to watch this moment of worship as this woman of God comes before us and blesses us tonight. I introduce to you the world, wherever you are. This is Jamila Carney dancing for us tonight. You all be blessed.
Show me your face, fill up this space, my world needs you right now, my world needs you right now, I can't being afraid, fill me with you.
Show me your face, fill up the space, my world needs you right now, my world needs you right now, I can't escape being afraid, fill me with you.
Bring with it a sign that points us to you right now. Erase substitutes right now. Fix what I see. And God, please fix me. My world needs you right now. Let us see you. Right now, power fall down.
sing with every sound that points us to you right now. Here at Substitutes right now. That's what I sing.
And God, please fix me.
And God, please fix me. My world needs you right now. Let us see you right now. Every heart in the world, God needs you to rescue. The storm has come and torn out hearts and tears. We need you. Show me your face. Fill up this space.
The world needs
my world needs you right now. My world needs you right now.
Storms may come, God, when we call your name, all things change. Kingdoms fall, longing for.
Wow, what an awesome outpour of worship. Sister Jamila, listen, bravo to you. Thank you so much for sending that moment of worship to us. We appreciate you so much She is the 4th Episcopal District of the AME Church's Dance Ministry Coordinator. And listen, sis, I appreciate you. She's a part of our eChurch family here at New St. Paul. And man, what an awesome display of worship tonight. Show me your face. Man, our world needs you. If that's not the most relevant song she could have selected for tonight for a moment of ministry, you know, she's right on point with what's going on in our world. Relevant ministry for a relevant time. Thank you so much, sis. I appreciate you. Again, if you're watching and you want to share in the revival of hope, look, I want the world to see how you're ministering. Look, did you see where she was? She was not at church. She's dancing at home. Yeah. She is dancing at home in the midst of what everybody else calls a crisis. She is still finding it necessary to worship wherever she is. Man, that's a powerful display of who God expects for us to be. He doesn't just expect for us to harness his power and to minister in power when we're in church. Man, if you don't know, I'm going to tell you right now, you are who you are everywhere you are. Yeah. Spring forth and dance. Break out and sing. Man, get on the instrument and play wherever you are. Let God get the glory out of your life, not just while you're in the walls of a church. Let God get the glory out of your life in the world. The world deserves to see what God has put on the inside of you. And in this time, in this season, guess what? All the rules are broken. All the limitations of what we thought was important are not. Listen, the seat that you used to sit in church, you ain't worried about that seat no more. You finding seats at home in your living room. You finding a seat in your office. You finding a seat around the dining room table. You finding a seat to worship God wherever you are. That's what God desires of us, to worship him in spirit and in truth, not just in building, but to find ourselves in his presence wherever we can find him. Guess what? Wherever we are, he always has a way of finding us. Amen. Won't you give Sister Jamila another hand? Thank you so much, sis. Thank you so much. Tonight, I want to share with you from the Word of God. All right? Are you ready? I hope you're ready. Hope you got your Bibles with you. You got your YouVersions, whatever kind of Bible you got. Go and pull your Bible out tonight. Yeah. I'm going to wait for you. I'm going to tell you why. Something different happens when you read the Word as you're hearing the Word. Something different happens when you're applying your eyes to the pages or to the screen as the Word of God is being read out of your mouth. Why? The Bible tells us that his word have we hidden in our hearts. And a lot of times the reason why when we get to our go-through, we got to call somebody else for a word is because we have not done what we need to do to hide the word in our hearts. So I know for a long time now, you done had your Bible app. And your Bible app is on your phone. And when it came time in church and you wanted to, they told you to pull your phone out. You pulled your phone out, but you didn't go to the Bible app. You checked your Facebook. You checked your text messages. Look, for this moment tonight, let's all read in the Word of God together. Okay, can we do that? Thank you. Thank you from wherever you are. We're going to read tonight. We're sharing from John chapter number 16. Yeah, St. John chapter number 16, the Gospel according to John chapter number 16. We're going to read verses 25 through 33. John chapter number 16, verses 25 through 33. You with me? I'm going to try it again. John chapter number 16, verses 25 through 33. I'm going to read it together in the King James Version, and then I'm going to read it again in the Message Bible. All right? I'm going to read it first in the King James Version, and then I'm going to read it in the Message Bible just to give us some clarity. Okay, here we go. John chapter number 16, verses 25 through 33. Here beginneth the reading of God's holy word. These things have I spoken unto you in Proverbs. But the time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. At that day ye shall ask in my name, and I will say not unto you that I will pray the Father for you. Verse 27 says, "For the Father himself loveth you, because ye have loved me, and have believed that I came out from God. I came forth from the Father, and I'm coming to the world again. I leave the world and go to the Father." Verse 29 says, "His disciples, Jesus' disciples said unto him, Lo, now speakest thou plainly, and speakest no proverbs. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest forth from God." Verse 31, "Jesus answered them, Do ye now believe? Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." Wow. Man, I can't wait to dig into this. Let's read it again from the Message Bible. John chapter number 16, verses 25 through 33. Here we go. "I've used figures of speech in telling you these things. Soon, I'll drop the figures and tell you about the Father in plain language. Then you can make your request directly to him in relation to this life I've revealed to you. I won't continue making requests on the Father on your behalf. I won't need to, because you've gone out on the limb and committed yourself to love and trust in me, believing that I came directly from the Father. The Father loves you directly. First, I left the Father and arrived in this world. Now I leave the world and travel to the Father." His disciples said, "Finally, you've given it to us straight in plain talk. No more figures of speech. Now we know that you know everything. It all comes together in you. You won't have to put up with our questions anymore. We're convinced that you came from God." Verse 31 says, "Jesus answered them, Do you finally believe? In fact, you're about to make a run for it, saving your own skins and abandoning me. But I'm not abandoned. The Father is with me. I've told you all this so that trusting me, you will be unshakable and assured, deeply at peace. In this godless world, you will continue to experience difficulties. But take heart, I've overcome the world. In this godless world, you will continue to experience difficulties. But take heart, I've overcome the world." I'm going to say it for you again. "In this godless world, you will continue to experience difficulties. But take heart, I've overcome the world." So far the scripture. Father, I ask that you bless this word on tonight. Let your word be illuminated so that people who are listening can hear from your spirit. God, it's been a challenging time. God, stand up tonight. Be who you've made us to be. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Listen, that's the word of God for the people of God. And wherever you are, won't you say, thanks be to God. Listen, a couple of days ago, a church member of mine called me after our first night of revival. She called me and she said, "Pastor, man, you preached a mighty word." I said, "Thank you, sis." Made me a little scared, tell you the truth. Said, "Thank you, sister. Thank you for your encouragement." Then she asked me this question. She said, "Pastor, I believe in God. I have strong faith. But I got a question. What good can come out of this? What good can come out of this? I know God can do anything but fail. I know that he has the whole world in his hands, like y'all been singing all over the place. I know that he has ordered our steps. I know that he has a plan in mind for us. But Pastor, I'm struggling. What good can come out of this?" I got an answer for you. Tonight, that's what I want to talk about. Touch your neighbor. Nope, don't touch him. Look at your neighbor if you got one. And say, neighbor, what good could come of this? Yeah, yeah. In this scripture, this gospel according to John, Jesus is revealing to his disciples that it's almost time. Yeah. He's been living in front of them day, night. They've been going to eat together. They've been going fishing together. They've been going to do ministry and feeding people on the side of the mountain together. They fed multitudes with a little bit of food. They've seen him heal blind eyes. They've seen him spit in the mud. Yeah, spit in the mud, rub his hands together with the solution, and put his hands on somebody's eyes, and they were able to see. Man, they've seen Jesus walk over to a cemetery and take a crazy man, call out to him, and then Jesus was able to free the man. Jesus has been doing some really, really, really interesting stuff. And the disciples, the 12, have been watching him all along. They've been watching him. They've been watching his life. They've been watching his witness. They've been watching him do things that nobody else has done. They've never seen the priest in the temple heal blind eyes. They've never seen the priest in the temple cause legs and limbs to be straightened out. They've never seen priests in the temple cause women to be free out of everybody's condemnation. Jesus is visiting people that the church people don't visit. Yeah. Jesus has courageous trust and faith in himself that he's taking this message of the Bible and making it plain. He's speaking in parables and making the mysteries that everybody had about the Torah and the Pentateuch and the law. He's causing all those things to be simple and plain. But now, he tells them now in verse 25, that I've been talking to you these mysteries out of parables. That's over. Yeah. I've been giving you the everyday English language of the Bible. You should be stronger than that now. Now it's time for you to be mature. Yeah. And because you're being mature, it's going to be testing time. This is going to be a time like you've never seen before. This is going to be the time where your faith and your trust and your hope is going to be put to the test. Because you know what I'm going to do? I ain't talking to y'all no more. I'm not going to try continuously to describe myself to you. But I'm going to speak to you plainly according to what God is saying. As a matter of fact, you're going to have to go to God for yourself. You're going to stop coming to me, asking me to pray hard prayers to God for you. Yeah, I'm your pastor. I'm Jesus. I'm discipling you. And I'm tired of you having to come to me to go to God on your behalf. The time is coming. The time is really now where you need to get ready. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about ready for a battle, ready for the fight. I'm talking about you need to be ready to be spiritually mature. It is time for you to stop coming to me with all of your problems and recognize that the same God that I pray to, I'm giving you access to him directly. Yeah, you don't have to come and tell me all your business anymore, Peter, James, and John. You ain't got to come and tell me all your business no more, Bartholomew. You ain't got to come to me, Matthew, and tell me about why we ain't got enough money. You ain't got to come to me no more. I'm going to give you direct VIP access. I don't want you to have any more limitations. I come that you might have life and life more abundantly. I've come to free you from all the bondage of the law. I've come to make access to you so you can go to God directly and for yourself. Yeah. Access granted. Okay. Now, it's going to get interesting after I give you this access. Because now you're responsible. You're responsible for this access. Oh, yeah. Because now that I'm giving you access to go to God for yourself, if you choose not to pray, you can't lean on me. Yeah. If you choose not to study the scriptures, you're not going to be able to lean on me. If you choose not to observe the law that God has given us, You're not going to be able to say Jesus can get us out of this. Now it's time for you to grow up. Now it's time for you to become mature. The question is, again, what good can come out of this? What good can come out of this crisis moment? Well, one, the best thing that's going to come out of this is you have an opportunity to finally mature. You have an opportunity to finally take responsibility for you. Too long have we been dependent. Too long have we had to wait until we get to church for somebody to lay hands on us, when all along you have the power of God in your own hands. Too long have we had to wait to get to church to ask the prayer warriors and intercessors to pray on our behalf when we've not said the first prayer ourselves. Too long have we had to come to the church and fill out a form and ask the church to help us with our bills when we haven't even gone to God and asked God to supply our needs according to his riches and glory. It's been too long for us coming to church, watching everybody else operate and performing their spiritual gifts and asking God, when is it going to be my chance? And when the Holy Spirit challenges you to step out and be the one, when the Holy Spirit challenges you to go on, don't wait for the praise team to tell you what to do. Go ahead and lift your hands anyway. During this season, the praise team ain't coming to your house. Yeah. Nope, they ain't coming. During this season, the worship leader's not going to pick out the song for you. Nope, they ain't picking them out. During this season, the organist is not going to be helping you to shout. No. During this season, you've got to mature. During this season, you're challenged to see who you really are in God. During this season, worship has got to become real for you. Reference back to Jesus meeting the woman at the well. The first conversation he has with her says that, I know that you're used to worshiping during a certain form. I know that you're used to worshiping in a certain place. I know that you're used to worshiping in a certain way with, you know, standing up on one leg, head to the side, mouth turned a certain way, looking at certain people. Raise your hands. Clap your hands. Shout. Go. Say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say God is worthy. God is worthy. I know that you're used to somebody leading you through worship. I know that you're used to somebody telling you what it should look like. But the time and season has come. And it now is when the worshipers are going to worship God in spirit and truth. Because God seeketh for us to worship him. What do you mean, spirit and truth, Pastor? I mean, did you feel what it felt like when you watched Sister Jamila dancing in God's presence in the midst of her kitchen? Now, that completely blows some people away because they're used to seeing us do church stuff in church spaces. We're used to seeing each other pray at church. Where do you pray at home? We're used to seeing someone call out a scripture for us to read at church. Who's going to pick out your scripture now? Yeah, now it's time for you to mature. You've been watching what we do in church for years. You can do it like the back of your hand. You can do that. Matter of fact, watch this. Some of you all know exactly who's going to pray every Sunday. You know what they're going to say. You know the words that they're going to use. You know how the prayer is going to start. Our Father and our God, from generation to generation, Lord, you have been there for us. You know how to do it. You know what key they go up in. You know when they turn their voice. And now, Lord, yeah. You know what that's like. Now God is challenging you. How does your prayer sound? Yeah. When the deacons and the ministers and the pastor's not there, How does it sound when you reach out to God? Now it's time for you to develop and experience what God can be like when it's just you and him. Yeah. When you've had your house full of family all day long and you need to steal away and get to your own intimate space, what book do you pick up? I know you want to turn on Netflix. I know you want to turn on Disney Plus. Man, the internet is so important to us right now. I'm glad you're using the internet to watch the revival. But I don't want you stuck on listening to me preach during this revival moment. The revival, believe it or not, is not happening on Facebook. The revival is happening in your everyday life if you choose to take the moment and the opportunity to be revived. A while ago, there was this song and the introduction of it said, "The revolution will not be televised." Guess what? This revolution of worship, this revolution of God pouring out, this awakening and revival that's getting ready to happen in the earth, it won't have to be televised because it'll be right in front of your face. Yeah. In this moment, in this season, in this hour, God is using what we think is a crisis to cause us to turn our faith to him like never before. Yeah, he's using this moment of isolation to pull us away from our distractions. He's using this moment of isolation to challenge us to become who he really called us to be. He's using this moment of isolation to cause people who ain't been to church in forever to turn their hearts back to him. Can any good thing come out of this? Yeah, you can arrive out of this at a place that's more mature than you ever thought you'd be. You can arrive out of this at a place that causes you to be on a deeper level with God. And imagine what it will be like when you're able to go back to the building. And you remember Sister Such and Such used to be quiet in the corner. And as soon as they say, "I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord," and Sister Such and Such pops up like a firecracker because she remembers what it was like not to fellowship with her brothers and sisters. She's just so glad to get back to the place of worship that ain't nobody, or ain't nothing you can do that'll stop her from raising her hands on that morning. Listen, let's dig deep, okay? His disciples said to him in verse 29, "Lo, Jesus, now you're speaking to us plainly. Finally, you're giving it to us straight. We ain't got to figure out," when he said that, when he said bread, was he really meaning bread or was it being metaphorically? Like, you know, Jesus is dropping bars on us, but we don't know if it's literal bars or figurative bars. When he says up, does he mean sideways? When he says down, what does he mean? Jesus says, "Hey, I'm going to talk to you plain now." Disciple says, "Hey, you finally talking to us plain. No more figures of speech. Now we know that you know everything. It all comes together in you. You won't have to put up. We ain't got to ask you more questions no more. You're proving to us that you're exactly who God says that you are." Listen, what's happening around you is not a parable. This is not a scriptural version of what might happen one day. This is for real, for real. This is our world in crisis all at the same time. Watch this. The crisis is so plain that no matter what language you speak, everybody is saying crisis. Yeah. No matter what dialect of the language you speak, everybody's saying crisis all at the same time. And just like everybody's saying crisis, everybody's answer is Christ. Out of a situation of desolation, we're finding ourselves unified. No matter what part of the world we're in, we're finding all of our minds all focused on the same thing at the same time. Now, think about how powerful that has been. Because we're all focused at the same thing at the same time, the NBA shut down. Because we're all focused at the same thing at the same time, fear is causing our government to crumble. Because we're all focused at the same thing at the same time, our economy is shifting all over the world. Because we're all focused at the same thing at the same time. Now, imagine what happens when God flips the script. Yeah. Imagine what happens when God snaps his fingers and does away with this. Will we still be all focused on the same thing at the same time? Will we still all be focused on prayer? Will we still all be focused on seeking God's face? We do a good job of running to God when it's time of desperation. What are you going to do when God lifts the covering of this virus? Guess what? The Bible tells us clearly that everything comes from God. Everything. She asked, what good can come out of this? Don't you see the good? That in a state of crisis, you become a community. At the state of crisis, it no longer matters whether or not you like your neighbor anymore. At the state of crisis, it doesn't matter how much money you make. It don't matter what, it don't matter how much education you have. It don't matter what level of job you got. It don't matter what title you are. Everybody is in a state of crisis. But guess what? Now that God has leveled the playing field, now that there's no difference between who has and who doesn't have, now that there's no difference between what neighborhood you live in, can we all come together for the sake of Christ? What good can come out of this? The church can come out of this and make a statement like never before. Yeah. The church can put aside her differences from one set of church to another set of church and come together. Yeah. The church across the street from your church should probably find out how y'all can meet in the middle of the street. Yeah, I know that you don't used to all that jumping and shouting music, but at the end of the day, all y'all praying at the same time. I know that you're not used to bowing down at the altar on Sunday mornings. You want to pray at your seat. Guess what? Now you ain't even got a seat or an altar to pray in. You've had to finally make an altar in your heart. You finally had to finally make an altar at your home. Now that the church, we've been talking about taking the church out of the church all along. And finally, you don't have a choice in the matter. Guess what? Pastors are preaching the word of God from their living rooms. Pastors are preaching the word of God outside. Guess what? We're finally becoming exactly who God wanted us to be. He told us in Jeremiah that he had a plan for our lives. I got a secret for you. This has been the plan all along. The creator longs and desires to get the creation's attention. The creator, God, has been asking all along for you to turn to him and stop depending on your bank account. What do you do when your bank account's no good? Turn to him and stop waiting till Sunday to get to the church. What you gonna do when your church won't open? To turn to him. Turn to his word. What good can come out of this? Man, people all over the world can turn their hearts and depend on God. What good can come out of this? Finally, in the midst of a crisis, people are calling, asking to be baptized. What good can come out of this? The world as you know it will be turned on its head, and the King of Kings will be revered as the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords will be revered as the Lord of Lords, and the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, that church. The kingdom aligned church. The ecclesia, the called out ones. The ones that God has set aside for his own personal use and his own personal worship. That church will arise from this. And no matter what it says on the side of your building, when you go back to your building, you'll go back to your building with another train of thought. Hey, he finishes by saying, behold, the hour cometh and is come, that ye shall be scattered. Every man to his own. Guess where you are? In your own house. Yeah. And shall leave me alone. For I am not alone, because the Father is with me. Here you go. Last verse. These things I have spoken unto you, that you might have peace. Not that you should be afraid, but that you can have peace. You're not separated to your homes so that you can worry. He did it so you can have peace. Yeah, guess what? A lot of us don't even have to worry about going to our jobs in this season. Why? Because the Lord has heard you complain about your job for months. Now you can be at home. But don't worry about how it happened. Don't get caught up in the fear of the crisis. Don't worry about that. Now he wants you to have peace. Guess what? And not just to have peace. In this world, he already told us, you shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer. That means put a smile on your face. I have overcome the world. Guess what? Because Christ overcame the world, we can overcome the crisis. Because Christ overcame the world, we can overcome our fears. Because Christ overcame the world, we can overcome these feelings of isolation. Because Christ overcame the world, we can overcome our despair and uncertainty. Because Christ overcame the world, we can overcome this desire for cures. Guess what? Now it's time for you to seek divine health and healing. Now it's time for you to be spiritually whole. Now it's time for you to realize that the good thing that can come out of this is you seeking God like he wanted you to seek him from the beginning. That's the answer to your question. What good can come out of this? At the end of the day, you finally realize that God has been in control all along. So here's the call to action. What do you do with this new information that God is in control? You allow him to have control. What do you do with this new information that Christ is in your crisis? Well, if Christ is sent for your crisis, I suggest you choose the Christ. What do you do with this information that says, what good could come out of this? The Bible says, be of good cheer. You can find peace in times of tribulation. You can find cheer in the time of crisis. The world is talking about a pandemic. I got a solution for that. The Bible clearly says that if my people who are called by my name humble themselves, turn from their wicked ways, then he'll heal the land. You want to make a change in the world? You want them to find the cure? Act like you've already got the cure. Now, just in case you didn't know, this cure is called Jesus. Yeah, the same Jesus that the disciples were talking to in this scripture is the same Jesus that you need in your life right now. The same Jesus that they wanted to talk plain, he's finally talking plain to you now. Yeah, it's not taking the King James Version for us to get it right now. Yeah, everybody understands what Christ is because they recognize that they don't want to live in crisis. Question for you. Will you choose him? You got a choice. Oh yeah, there's a choice. You can either choose to listen to the crisis, or you can choose to accept the Christ. You can choose to listen to the damnation and tribulation of the crisis, or you can listen to the liberation and freeing of the Christ. You can choose to have your mind stuck in the quarantine of crisis, or you can have your mind stuck in the freedom and liberty that comes with Christ. You get to choose. And it's a simple choice. And it don't take a whole lot of stuff. Guess what? You ain't in church no more. You ain't got to be afraid to stand up beside your neighbor. You ain't got to think about what they're going to think about you. There ain't no aisle for you to walk down. Right where you are, in your living room, in your car, in your bedroom, outside on the playground, wherever you are, you can get an answer to the crisis right now. And it's simple. Accept, believe, confess. Simple as ABC. Let's try it again. Accept, believe, confess. The Bible says Jesus stands at the doorway of our heart and knocks on the door. And maybe tonight, while you've been listening to this message, he's been knocking on your door. Maybe while you were watching the news, he was knocking on your door. Once he knocks on your door, if Jesus comes and knocks on your door, the best thing for you to do is open the door and let him in. Because once he comes into your heart, man, you're talking about VIP access. Now you really get to go to the front of the line. Oh, yeah. You get a membership has its privileges type experience. Yeah. Guess what happens when Jesus comes into your heart? He takes away all that fear and worry and doubt and lets you know that, hey, this is happening around you, but this ain't it. Because guess what? At the end of this crisis, at the end of whatever's going to happen down here, once you let me in your heart, you get a VIP ticket to an experience you ain't never seen before. It's better than any concert you've ever been to. It's better than any NBA game that got canceled. It's better than any show. It's better than any Netflix show. It's better than anything you've ever imagined. Imagine living in eternity with Christ. Imagine living in mansions that have been prepared for us. Imagine not having any worries anymore. Imagine not having to pay any more bills. Imagine not having any more aches and pains. Imagine not having to figure out where your next resource is coming from, because it's all been laid out for you. Oh yeah, he left here to prepare a place for you. And because he's left, he's waiting for us to come to where he is. All you got to do is accept him. You ain't got to be alone. The Bible says that he'll never leave us or forsake us. Those of us who have Christ on the inside, we're not worried about isolation because God is with us everywhere we are. Man, now listen, once you accept Christ, once you let him into your heart, you got to believe. You got to believe that God raised Jesus from the dead, because it's in him raising from the dead that the gift of salvation is made available to us. Yeah. It's the fact that Jesus is waiting for us, sitting on the right hand of God, waiting for time to be ended, waiting for the crisis to be over so that he can come back and redeem us to him. That's what the VIP ticket is for. It ain't just to get to the gate. It ain't just to go inside, but it's for us to reign with Christ forever, to be on top. Yeah, I know you've always been, you know, worried about how much people are better than you. Guess what? Accepting Christ on the inside of you causes you to go exactly to the top. You've been waiting for a promotion. This is the best promotion you ever gonna have. Accepting Christ, believing God raised him from the dead, and confessing out of your mouth that Jesus is the Lord of your life. Why I gotta confess? Man, listen, opening your mouth and hearing yourself say that Jesus has saved you, once you hear, I'm saved, once you hear yourself saying, I'm saved, man, that just breaks something in the atmosphere. It makes all the worry and all the doubt that you had in your mind, it makes that all disappear. It makes you realize that it's all been about this. What good can come out of this? The good is you can accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior right now. Won't you do it? Won't you let him in your heart? Okay, you want me to do it? I'll do it with you. Come on. All over the world, wherever you are, let's do it with them. They're ready to make the decision. They're in their living room crying. They're finally seeing that there's a way out. They're finally seeing that there's a way of escape. Let's all join together. Let's put our hands together. And for this one moment, let's just focus on those who are getting ready to make this life-changing decision for Christ. Listen, if you're listening to me right now, do this with me. It's called a prayer of salvation. I'm going to lead you. All I want you to do is repeat what I say. It's going to be real easy, okay? Here we go. Jesus, come into my heart. I open the door. I accept you inside. I believe that you are God's son. I believe that you went to the cross for the forgiveness of my sins. I believe that you died on that cross. I believe that on the third day, God raised you from the dead. When he raised you from the dead, I believe he gave you all power. I believe that you're coming back. I believe that when you're coming back, you're going to come back for me. I believe that when you come back for me, that I'm going to live with you in eternity. Jesus, I confess that I've done some wrong things. Please forgive me. Wash my heart. I want to be new. I confess that I need you as the Lord of my life. I'm going to live my life for you. I'm going to follow your instructions. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Thank you, Jesus, for making me new. I am saved. I am saved. I am free. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, wherever you are, I don't care what you're doing. Don't drop your pots and pans, but just go bonkers and crazy and praising God because somebody somewhere accepted Jesus as the Lord of their life for the first time. Listen, that's what this has been all about. The revival of hope is to bring you hope to where you are, but not just to bring you hope, but to bring you a new life in Christ. I'm so excited. I'm so excited that you decided to choose Christ tonight. Listen, this has been the revival of hope. This is exactly where our God wants us to be. There is a Christ for you in the midst of your crisis. What good can come out of this? You can come out of this changed. You can come out of this new, and you can come out of this free. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Join us again tomorrow, 9 a.m., for our morning glory prayer intercession. We're going to be praying together with people all over the globe. At noon, we're going to have our hour of power. A mighty word, a Bible study is going to come for you tomorrow at noon. And then tomorrow night at 7 p.m., another night of word and worship. This is the Revival of Hope. My name is Pastor RJ Stevenson here at New St. Paul in Tampa. Thank you so much for joining us. Sister Jamila Carney, bravo to you. Thank you so much for blessing us with your ministry of dance tonight. Until tomorrow night, God bless you all. We'll see you then.